Okay, so good morning to my student. Today we are going to learn. I'll show you one practical example for a rotor dynamic system. How to find out the natural frequency? That means when you are going to calculate the natural frequency, definitely we already understand that stiffness of the entire rotating system is involved. So directly for the direct measurement of stiffness of such complicated structure may not be that much easy. And also, you know, when the damping is involved, every structure having some damping, less or more. So there also it is not so easy to for the direct measurement of that. So how to do that? I will show you. I have carried out one experiment. Means this I used to do with my student who are coming to me for rotor dynamic course. Practically in hand I used to show them this. So first let us show me the setup which I use. You see, this is the rotor. Here so many holes are there. So this rotor weight is around 6 kg. And this distance, this is I think around 150 mm. This is 150 mm. And to carry out the experiment, that bolt is that side. Here I tight one bolt. That bolt weight is, I think, I'll tell you what is the weight. That may be 200 or 100 gram or something I added. Then if I rotate this, I rotated this at 20 hertz. And here in the top, that setup I removed actually. Here I put a proximity. Because this, once this unbalance is there, so it will vibrate like this. So I took that data, basically that is XT data. Okay, so your excitation, we know the equation of this is X double dot plus 2 Xi omega n X dot plus omega n square x, that is equal to f0 by m into sine 2 pi ft. So in this case, what is F0? F0 is equal to M0 omega square E. This is my F. So here my F is 20 hertz. M is total mass, that means 6 kg plus unbalance, that is 150 gram, I think, 50 gram. So it is 6.05 kg. And M0, that is 50 gram, omega, that is 2 pi f, f is 20 hertz, so 2 pi f means 40 pi, and E is equal to 150 mm. So with that, I took the data, okay. So this is the motor. This is the prime mover through which it is getting rotated. and sometime I need to see the cranking mechanism also. So that's why when you see here the rotational motion, it will translate to reciprocating motion. So when I need to simulate any cranking mechanism, I use this one. That is not a part of this course. And suppose I want double rotor, double plane. So many things are there that I used to simulate and show to my intern and student through this setup. So that's why I am giving one idea what is this setup. Okay, it's very simple setup. You can change it also, because you see here this screw, this Allen key screw, if you open and move here, it is presently it is short bearing. The setup is in short bearing. I am planning to improve it to for hydrodynamic bearing or journal, because most of the high speed this machine, this system, I can rotate up to I think 10,000 RPM. I can go up to 10,000 RPM. This is a BLDC. This is a BLDC machine. So this is the overall setup. Okay, I use this disc for my measurement, and here I kept the proximity. So this is all about the setup. You know, this is the setup, and it was fixed very rigidly. The entire I kept here, but during the data, while I was taking the data, it was one base. It was very tightly, very rigidly. It was the data was taken. Okay, so this is the data. I have calculated this. You see, as I told, M0, that is 50 gram. And omega square, so 2 pi f, 50 hertz I operated for that calculation, for that experiment. So 20 hertz, so 2 pi into 20 square, r is 150 mm, then sine 2 pi ft divided by the total mass. Okay, so this is my, and this is the xt, the fourth column is the output for my experiment, and F0 is the input. So already we know that. Now we are going to MATLAB. Let us define a data type, and I will import that data to my MATLAB workspace. Okay, the command is xls read, then the file name, this is vib data1.csv. Then my input is the third column. So D all row third column, and my output is all row fourth column. Okay, so my input and output data I obtained. Now let us open the system identification tool. This is the system identity, and if you see that I have used a sampling time of 10 to the power minus 5 second. So this is my system identification tool. I want to import the time domain data, because real time everything will be time domain data. I given the name. If you see the workspace, here you see this is in and out. So in and this is out. I started from 0, and the sampling time is, as I told, 10 to the power minus 5. So I will import that data. उसे डेटा हैज बीन इम्पोर्टेड and we know this my transfer function. So my transfer function, that means output, that means xt divided by ft, that is the excitation due to unbalance, that is equal to something, basically 1 by constant, I am not writing some, this is sorry, Laplace domain s square plus 2 xi omega ns plus omega n square. So this is a transfer function, is a second order. So we are having number of pole is the basically the roots of the denominator, so that is 2. And number of zeros is the roots of the numerator, so that is no function, it is no zero. So this is basically the thing. So now if I open the transfer function model, so it is asking number of pole 2, but number of zero it is 0. Let us estimate. It is estimating, till it is estimating there will be a rates symbol in the stop. Once over it will be become inactive. You see, now estimation is over. Sorry, now you just right click on the TF1. You see, this is the transfer function denominator. So that is, you see, top is the numerator is equal to approximately equal to 1, and this is second order, it is s square plus 504s plus 63460, that is my omega n square. So let us, this is the thing, 6, so I got the omega square, and this 504 is the 2 xi omega ns. So let us find out the natural frequency for this particular arrangement. Okay, so this is 63460. So 63460. So this is my natural frequency. That much, the 252 is the natural frequency. Okay, then what should be the RPM? We know omega is equal to pi n by 30. Omega is equal to pi n by 30. That means 30 omega by pi. So 30 omega by pi. So this is my RPM. The critical speed of that particular arrangement is 2405 RPM. So if I operate that machine 2405 RPM, more vibration will come, more displacement will come. That if I cannot show you, that video is not there. If I going beyond 2000 RPM, that it is going towards resonance, and the impedance, the entire impedance of the system is getting suddenly reduced, so that the it is giving the impulsive response. Okay, so I got the critical speed. Now I want to check what is the damping. So if you see that transfer function, so this is 504 and it is 252, so my damping is 2 xi omega ns. So 252, 504, 1. So it is critically damped. For that critically damped, so xi is equal to 1. So you can find out, because theoretically also by calculation we can find out, because we know my omega n a root over k by m. So by this method we already got the omega m. M is known, you can find out the k. And this part, this 2j omega n basically that is what was the equation basically? mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx. So divided both side by m. So this is c by m. So we know zeta, omega and m. You can find out the damping coefficient also. So this is the whatever we have learned, I have shown you practically how from the say there is a rotor. If you inside in situ after installation, if you want to find out the critical speed of the system and the damping of the entire system, then you can use this. But the thing is, the sensor, the proximity sensor, that should be very accurate, otherwise it may give erratic result, because entire estimation we are doing from the time domain data only. You should be very very careful on that, and the sampling, it should be very high speed sampling should be used. Okay, so this is the thing I only want to show you. Another thing I want to tell with this, after that we'll end up this lecture. Say sometime, say there are 10 similar system or 20 similar system in a plant. So during maintenance, you can collect say one machine, the bearing loose and it is giving unwanted vibration. You record those data. All kind of, say for 2 years, you record the all the faulty characteristics. That means the displacement data, time domain data, and you make a database. Because today this is the time people are going for big data analytics, rather than going to the classical concept. People are running behind this big data analytics, data mining and all these things, machine learning, neural network. All these things are getting popularized because people don't want to, because today we have a huge computational facility, computational strength is more. So rather than going to the dynamics, by collecting huge number of data, from there we can predict the behavior. Okay, so say in that way we some faulty characteristics we gathered, we accumulated, and later on if any kind of fault is occurring, so first we will match with the already collected faulty data, and easily we can tell if any one of the signal is matching with that, then we can tell that okay, this problem is there, without going to any further details. So that time your signal similarity, finding the signal similarity is required by seeing, because that vibration data will be very random in nature, and seeing in your seeing the plot, it is very difficult. So we will see how to find out the signal similarities. So I don't have so many practical data, that random data, so I will show you these things by sinusoidal signal. Let us see one signal I am defining. This is sine omega t. So first I will take, so t I am taking from 0 to with a sampling of 1 millisecond. So 1 millisecond, this is the 1 millisecond, and I am going up to 0.1 second. देन वाई दिस सिग्नल एक्चुअली से दिस इज साइन टू पाई से दिस इज 50 हर्ट्ज now this is my actual say this is my one faulty signal already I have after some time I got another signal from another machine say this is y1 this is sine 2 pi 50 hertz signal but there is a phase lagging say pi by 2 another signal y2 which is not at all that 50 hertz say that is 30 hertz simply that now if you plot all these three signal y comma t comma y comma t comma y1 comma t comma y2 if you plot here it may be somewhat you can find out the similarities but actually these all these signals will be random in nature vibration you know that is a discrete signal so you may not able to find it out so for that I will show you the technique we will use one function called autocorrelation or cross correlation so this is say this is the amplitude and the lagging because always it may not match there should be some lag okay the syntax is cross correlation we want to do y and y1 let us see how it should be. So I want to normalize the coefficient so that is say it is c1 so normalize means I have to divide all the c of its maximum value so maximum absolute value of c all rows so it is got normalized now let us plot that my lag into sampling was 1 millisecond comma my c1 let us plot it see in this plot you get a peak you are getting a dominant peak so let us see what is that peak you see that is minus 5 millisecond okay that means if you see the signal definition it was lagged by pi by 2 so my actual signal was 50 hertz so half period is 10 hertz half of that quarter period is half of that means 5 millisecond so you see that's why in this plot we are seeing that it is lagged by 5 milliseconds so we can tell the y and y1 signal the y and y1 signal are similar but there is a lagging now let us do the same thing for another signal which is not at all matching let us see what should be the result so that is y2 you see here it is nothing it is that no dominant peak is there so we can tell that y and y2 signal are not similar. So this is the technique to find out the signal similarities. This you should also know as a part of maintenance. As I told, if you are making a database, and from there you first going to any other analysis, first you want to check whether my faulty system is matching with any one of the data already we collected and that analysis has been done. This will save the time. So this only the things I want to tell. So hope you understand everything. So thank you so much.